the bacon burns the breeze. Twining round the second story, knowing that she's really part of these. And a lover like the evening primrose, spreading her perfume before the night. And deep within her heart she knows, she's sitting on a keg of dynamite. While in flower, overpower, it's our hour. While in flower, overpower, it's our hour.
NAL's Special Collections is conducting a series of oral history interviews with outstanding scientists whose research has made a significant contribution to American agriculture. Scientists from various USDA organizations, such as the USDA Agricultural Research Service, are participating. NAL will catalog each videotape oral history and will input the citations into the Agricola and OCLC databases, thereby providing national and worldwide access. As a matter of standing practice and understanding, all oral history videotapes and their content conducted by the National Agricultural Library will become part of the public domain for future use by national and international audiences. Today is Thursday, August 18th, 1988. My name is Jane Gates. I will be interviewing Dr. James A. Duke, and he's here beside me, and we're going to ask him to sign this release form. This interview is co-sponsored by the National Agricultural Library's Alternative Farming Systems Information Center. Dr. Duke, as interviewee.
I'll sign it James A., but I do hope you'll call me Jim.
Well, thank you. I will call you Jim. Thank you. And I'm Jane Gates, as I said, and it is an honor to be interviewing you today. And before we get started on the nitty-gritty of the interview, I wanted to ask you about the music from the album called Herbal Album.
Well, we certainly can't call that an outstanding contribution to U.S. agriculture, but music has been a hobby of mine for many, many years. As a matter of fact, when I started college, I started as a music major. And didn't like what they were trying to teach me about music, so I switched over to botany in my first semester. That was a good choice. That kept music where it should be as an avocation and made botany my vocation.
You haven't regretted that?
I've never regretted that.
And you've kept up your interest in music? I know there's a wonderful picture in here.
Oh, that's my musical group at the Durham Station, which is still extant. And you can see they play sort of earthy music.
Earthy music?
Earthy music, what we call bluegrass.
So not country. There's a difference between...
There's a difference between country and bluegrass. As a matter of fact, across the street, we had a concert about 3 weeks ago, which beautifully illustrated the difference between bluegrass and country. But I don't think we want to get into that here.
Well, I don't know. Maybe you'll make another interview.
Okay.
If people are interested in your music, can they contact you through ARS, or do you have...
I would much rather they contacted me at home if they were going to contact me about my hobbies.
All right. I think that's more appropriate. Could we get then to the nitty-gritty of having and come back to the music later on?
Let's do and see what happens.
All right. I'd like, first of all, to ask you about your family background. Duke, the family surname.
Well, I have a poem in the little blue book that you were looking at about that. I come from cotton-picking Dukes instead of the tobacco Dukes.
Uh-huh.
I come from the red clay hills of Alabama. And you can find a Duke on almost every hill out near Birmingham, where I was raised. And my family is conventional Scotch-Irish in origin. And we lived in the hills of Alabama or in Birmingham until I was 8. Then I moved to North Carolina.
So So you were in Alabama until you were 8.
That's correct.
Did your parents tell you stories about your ancestors, your grandparents from Scotland and Ireland?
No, I don't remember any of that at all. I had such a big extended family that we were so occupied with the current members that we never got back into the roots of it.
How many siblings?
Well, my immediate family, I had 2 brothers. Mm-hmm. But my father came from a family of 11, and my mother came from a family of 9, one of whom died of typhus.
And they all lived in that area?
They all lived in that area.
Living ones?
We would get together as often as we could.
No wonder you said it was a large extended family with no time to look back. Were your names James A, and should I ask you what the A stands for, or do
the
you?
The A stands for Alan, A-L-A-N. Mm-hmm. And I don't really know the significance of my own name. That's embarrassing. But out there I had an Uncle Jim and a grandfather James, so I presume it's for my maternal grandfather.
Well, you've certainly made it a significant name on your own. There's no reason to feel apologetic about not knowing who you were named for. What did your father do for a living?
My father was a farmer. He was a cotton farmer, and he went into horticulture and nursery. And in the years of the Depression, we moved to North Carolina, and he became an insurance salesman. And that was the first time that we weren't in dire straits. After he'd been in insurance for about a year or two, he ended up playing golf and eating meat and potatoes instead of the high-fiber rural diet to which we'd become accustomed.
I was going to ask you about dire straits. When you say it means high-fiber rural diet?
Rural.
Right.
Uh-huh. We were poor, plain old poor, until we got to North Carolina. And we had to eat what we could find lots of times, and most of that was homegrown and home canned.
So your parents had a garden?
They had a garden, and they had uncles, cousins, brothers who had big farms, and so there was plenty of produce for that.
Mm-hmm. What do you remember eating particularly that was?
Well, my favorite recollections of Alabama are scuppernongs and scuppernong juice, a grape that I think I put the northern dot on the map up here. It's Vitis rotundifolia, and it is a redneck grape like our redneck purposes. But I've gotten it to grow on the south side of my place, behind the barn, facing south. And I've gotten about 10 grapes there, and I think it's the northern dot on the Vitis rotundifolia map, but it's a favorite. But I miss my scuppernongs.
And you had them just
they
playing?
They grew behind my grandmother's house, and from late August until frost, you ate them off the vine, but she would always prepare marmalades, jellies, and a treasure called scuppernong juice, which I only had there.
Did you remember any particular vegetables like okra, which I always associate
okra
with the
okra? I never learned to enjoy until I was about 40. Now I eat it raw and cooked, but too many of the things that I enjoy now were repugnant to me as a young redneck.
It's wonderful that we can change as we grow older, isn't it? So the place in Alabama, I don't want to leave that quite yet. You were born in a hospital, or were you born at home?
I was born at home, and we had a black midwife who was almost part of the family then.
Mm-hmm.
And at the time, my grandmother lived in Birmingham, Alabama, but we had a farm about 40 miles out from Birmingham, and my first 6 years were spent wavering between those two. The farm was on the Coosa River.
Coosa?
K-O-O-S-A.
Uh-huh.
You remember there's a lot of things down there, Appaloosa, Calcoosa.
Uh-huh. I've never heard of Coosa.
Names. And for a while I thought that I had Indian ancestry. I do have an Aunt Extra, but her part of the family tree went another direction. She was Cherokee, but I don't have any Cherokee blood in me to the best of my knowledge, which sort of negates one of the poems I wrote thinking that I had some Cherokee blood. I got to digging, and it's not quite true.
Well, Aunt Exra?
E-X-R-A.
E-X-R-A. What other aunts and uncles do you remember particularly?
Well, Uncle Roland was the most obese of us all. And I remember him sitting on the front porch, and I was trying to make conversation. Said, "What you raising this year?" And he said, "Can't grow nothing but weeds." When you're six, that was rather pertinent.
Yes.
But he was usually on that porch, sitting on the porch, and I reckon that's why the weeds were doing so well.
Did he just sit there? Did he chew tobacco?
Or? He did chew tobacco. He was the only one that I remember to chew tobacco. One of my other uncles smoked, but my father was a teetotaler and a non-smoker.
And as a child, did you try such things, or did you want to skip that part?
I think I first tried the cigarette when I was within a stone's throw of Liggett and Myers in Durham, North Carolina, at about 9 years old.
So you waited till you moved north.
I don't
north.
Remember it happening in Alabama, though.